our celebration of Holy Communion on this, the third Sunday of Epiphany. We're just going to have a moment's quiet just to gather our thoughts before we worship God, and then we'll stand to sing our first hymn, which this morning will be hymn number 36. But then we're going to start our service in a slightly different way after we've sung the hymn, because we have two people to introduce to you this morning. So I'll be asking them to come forward just to introduce themselves before our service begins. But for now, we're going to just have a moment's quiet and then hymn number 36. To take students on placement, and at the moment we are blessed, we are doubly blessed, in that we have two students with us, so one of which you may already have met, and I'm going to ask her to come forward first to introduce herself. That is Yvonne. And so Yvonne, if you'd like to just come and say a little bit about where you are and how you are to find yourself in this place, that'd be lovely.
Hello,
Hello.
Nice to be here. Well, I'm from London, and around 5 years ago, I decided perhaps I should listen to God, because he talks a lot when he doesn't get his own way, and decided it was right to pursue ordained ministry. The journey was a bit of a rocky road, so I had a little interval where I felt, okay, maybe I'm not quite ready, and then COVID hit. And as most people do, with time in their hands, I pondered, and God prodded even more so. So I went on the discernment journey and was accepted and decided to leave London, not sure where, but my heart was always north for some reason. I have connections in the north. So I visited the College of the Resurrection. I knew immediately that was the right place for me. It took some prayer and a lot of, pushing myself. And so here I am, 2 years, ordained ministry. So I'm doing my work placement here at St. Mary's in here also. And I hope to learn a lot more about what it means to be a priest. And to indulge myself in spirituality, in the people of the North, and all that we will share together. So that's why it's all. so far, and I look forward to sharing more with you all. Thank you.
And also, a great delight to introduce Alison, who will be sitting there, who is, again, also studying at the college, but not, this is for lay ministry, isn't it? So, just like to say a few words about yourself, Alison.
Yes, I am Alison, and I'm
a
lay minister. Series of coincidences which meant I actually couldn't ignore any longer that I was called to do something. And so I am now trained to be a licensed lay minister. I'm in my first year, I'm only in my second term, so I'm very green and I will make lots of mistakes, please be kind. Some of you, it's very difficult with masks, I may recognise some of you, I certainly recognise Chris, because I run the little computer shop just over the hill with my husband, and I've got two youngish children. It's lovely to be sort of like somewhere that's so close to home, and I'm really looking forward to getting to know you all a little bit better.
Thank you. That's lovely. Well, it's delight. Both of them will be with us until Easter. Alison will be available and around during the day more than Yvonne, who is really just on Sunday. Some of you may already have met her because last week she was with me, shadowing me on a number of things throughout the week, but that only lasts a week, unfortunately. So we look forward to working with them, and do talk to them, make them feel welcome, and find out a little bit about more about their journey and their life and their call. But for now, we're going to stand, and our worship will continue on page 3 of our order of service. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Blessed are you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You reveal yourself to the world in 3 wonders. A star leads the wise men to the manger.
Hallelujah.
Jesus is revealed as the Christ in the waters of baptism.
Hallelujah.
The water is made into wine at the wedding feast.
Hallelujah.
Lord of grace and truth, we confess our unworthiness to stand in your presence as your children. We have sinned.
Forgive us.
The Virgin Mary accepted your call to be the mother of Jesus. Forgive our disobedience of your will. We have sinned.
Forgive us.
Your Son, our Saviour, was born in poverty in a manger. Forgive our greed and rejection of your ways. We have sinned.
Forgive us.
The shepherd left their flocks to go to Bethlehem. Forgive our self-interest and lack of vision. We have sinned.
Forgive us.
The wise men followed the star to find Jesus the King. Forgive our reluctance to seek you. We have sinned.
Forgive us.
May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw you to himself and cleanse you from all your sins, that you may behold the glory of his Son, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Son proclaimed good news to the poor, release to the captives, and freedom to the oppressed. Anoint us with your Holy Spirit, and set all your people free to praise you in Christ our Lord. Amen. And we sit now for our first.
Reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot say, look aside, not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, look aside, not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head of the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honourable be clothed with great honour, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honour to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honoured, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ, individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. Apostles are all prophets, are all teachers, do all work miracles, do all possess gifts of healing, do all speak in tongues, do all interpret, but strive for the greater gifts. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unscrolled the scroll and found a place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I can't believe it's 45 years since Star Wars came out. That's an odd thing to think about. But I can still remember vividly seeing it. It would have been in the cinema, because of course 45 years ago there was sort of the beginnings, I think, of video, but nothing like the access to online films or whatever there is today. It would have been the cinema, it would have been a big screen, and I can remember vividly that opening section of Star Wars, where you had the writing going away from you, being read out to you, and then this tiny little spacecraft across the screen, and then this huge spaceship just filled the screen. It started coming across and it came, got bigger and bigger and bigger. They were fighting. But it was just that opening moment of Star Wars, which was really that I had experienced before. Beginnings, how you start things, can be very memorable. And the first line of a book, maybe, or maybe the first scene in a film, as with that, they can determine the success or the failure. And they must have thought that through, I think, very carefully. Authors do, directors do. They spend a lot of time working on openings. And some like that were not for me, I don't know about for you, but were for me, but truly memorable. Now, in today's Gospel reading, we have a beginning. We have Luke's account of the beginning of Jesus' adult ministry. There he is in the synagogue, where he grew up, in Nazareth. So according to Luke, how did Jesus choose to launch his ministry? He went back home. He went back home to his own town. In the synagogue at Nazareth, he stood up there in front of the people and he read that passage from the prophet Isaiah. And it summed up really the heart of his mission. Good news for the poor, blind, new sight to set the downtrodden free. And the people, were told, at least initially, liked what they heard. Initially, their reaction was very positive. He spoke with authority. Here was a man you could believe in, not like the usual teachers or preachers, not like the establishment types with vested interests. If you look ahead, if you leap ahead, as it were, to next week's Gospel, you can see just how quickly that attitude in some people's minds changed. You can almost hear, as it were, the whirring of the people's minds. They're clicking over and thinking through the and speaks about good news for the poor, what does that mean for us who are comfortably off? He speaks of liberty for captives, but perhaps we'd prefer to lock them up and throw away the keys. He speaks of freedom for the downtrodden. What do we really want? Can we afford a society where everyone is treated the same? People's self-interests, they begin to take over. And it's not long before they're trying to get rid of this man who talks about such things. Now, how do we react? How do we react to Jesus' message today? Because it's not just a message from history, although Luke is careful to set it in historical context, really to remind us that it's based on eyewitness evidence. What is Jesus doing as his opening? Because he's not just setting out his own agenda, but he's actually proclaiming the word of God. He's going back to the prophets to proclaim that this is part of God's plan from ages past, part of what is called our salvation history. And at the heart of this plan is the word of God revealed in the Old Testament, in the scriptures. Now the people, when the people of Israel returned to their homeland after years of exile in Babylon, their return was marked by a public reading of the whole of the book of the law, the words of the Lord their God, which had been revealed to them, the very heart, really, of their religion. And we're told that these words contain a great teaching. The Bible is the book of the Lord's people, who, in listening to it, move from being dispersed and divided towards the unity. The word of God unites believers and makes them into one people, the same way as we read about in our other reading. We are the body of Christ, we are dependent upon one another. Each part is at least as important as any of the others, and they all rely on one another. Now Jesus talks about himself as being the fulfillment of prophecy. And indeed, if you look back through the Old Testament, you can find, as it were, flashes of images that do speak very heavily about Jesus and who he is going to be. If you look back and you examine it carefully, there are little pictures of him popping up here, there, and everywhere. I always think back to when we hear about Jesus on the road to Emmaus with those two disciples that are walking along, and he tells them, he points where he is and how he has been, as it were, foretold. So he is the fulfillment of a prophecy. God has come to be with God's people, and that was promised. That was promised in the Old Testament. But Jesus looks to the future too, because he is setting out, as it were, like a political party, a manifesto. The mission statement of his church. It's based both on the word of God, but also on the spirit of God. Jesus is able to fulfill this ancient prophecy because the spirit has been given to him. He proclaims God's will in the power of the spirit. In the power of the spirit, he will fulfill God's will, bringing that good news to the poor, liberty to the captives, new sight to the blind, freedom to the downtrodden. And that's what God has anointed him to do. And it is something that can only really be achieved in that power of God's Spirit. So today, Jesus invites us who share that same Spirit through our baptism to be a part of that mission. He went back to his hometown to begin it, and he actually calls us to do something very similar. If we are to share in that mission that he has laid out, this is where we start among the people that we know. Amen. Now we stand to affirm our faith.
through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Sit.
We come to you, Lord, in love and trust. We thank you for your many gifts to us. We thank you for your Son who performed miracles and prophesied. We believe and trust in you and pray that you will come to us today in spirit to renew our faith in you. We pray for our Christian leaders, Hugh, Cindy, Helen, Evan and Alison. We pray for our ministry and pastoral teams, our church wardens and all members of the PCC and committees. We pray for all those who work with children in our parish, especially those who have managed and taken part in our annual parish pantomime. We pray, Lord, that as we see COVID restrictions ease, we will see more children participate in Sunday school, workshop activities, choir, and many more activities designed for them. We pray for all those recently baptized into the church. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray, Lord, that you will bestow on world leaders your gifts of peace and tolerance to prevent war and all forms of international aggression. We pray for all those who live with the fear of war. We pray for the souls of all lives lost in war. May you give strength to all those displaced. And we pray that the thousands of refugees may find a new home. We pray for all those millions who live in refugee camps throughout the world. We thank you, Lord, for those who help the less fortunate. Their work is often a drop in the ocean, but individuals have created massive positive change, and we thank you for their intervention. We thank you, Lord, for the work of Christian Aid. We look to our own country, Lord, and pray that those in authority at all levels in our society conduct themselves with truthfulness and honesty. We pray, Lord, for a day when there will be no abuse of power in any nation. Lord, in your mercy. We pray, Lord, for all the doctors, nurses, and health service workers. We await test results and diagnoses, attend clinics, those who are recovering from illnesses who need help. We thank you, Lord, for all the professional help which is available to us. We give you thanks, Lord, for our many friendships and acquaintances, our families and our neighbours. We ask you, Lord, to bless our homes with love and peace. Help us, Lord, care for those we love, and with patience and understanding, as your Son served us. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who mourn the death of a loved one. We pray for those who are sick. Allow us, Lord, to support the carers who, in supporting those who are ill, have been there sometimes for a long time. Help us remember those who have lost loved ones and will continue to grieve. Help us be there for those who need help, even if it's just to show kindness. We pray this morning for Malcolm Spink. May your living word bring comfort and healing to all those in need. We come to you this morning with our own prayers. Lord, in your mercy, we praise you, Lord, for our privileged lives. Help us look forward with joy this year as COVID restrictions are lifted and we prepare for a spring of new freedoms and optimism. Thank you, Lord. Merciful Father,
accept your prayer for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Stand as able for us. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and his name shall be called the Prince of Peace. And the peace of the Lord be always with you.
God so is with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of God's peace.
Thank you.
to give thanks and praise.
All honour and praise be yours, always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For at this time, we celebrate your glory made present in our midst. In the coming of the Magi, the King of all the world was revealed to the nations. In the waters of baptism, Jesus was revealed as the Christ, the Saviour sent to redeem us. In the water made wine, the new creation was revealed at the wedding feast. Poverty was turned to riches, sorrow into joy. Therefore, with all the angels of heaven, we lift our voices to proclaim the glory of your name and sing our joyful hymn of praise. Same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits you have given me, for all the pains and insults you have borne for me. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may I know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. God's holy gifts for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Body of Christ. The blood of
We thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all peoples. Amen. Now, for our final hymn, blessing and dismissal, just a quick look at the notices for today. This afternoon at 3 o'clock, there is a service which is at the end of the week of prayer for Christian unity, which we have just, or it's week, day six, I think we're in now, the week of prayer for Christian unity. And this is, as always, organised through Churches Together, the ecumenical group here in Murfield. And that is then followed by their annual general meeting. And everybody is welcome to come along to both the service and the meeting if they wish to do so. There'll be an update on COVID precautions as of next week. Nothing has changed as of this week because the new regulations coming as from Thursday. So we're going to meet on Monday just to see what the implications are, and hopefully then any decisions that are being passed down from the diocese and the national church hopefully will have arrived, and we can then start thinking about how it's going to impact us at a local level. But obviously, in terms of government restrictions and legalities, things are relaxing very quickly now. So we'll just have to see how that works out in terms of the medical advice that's being given out at the same time, and how we best keep ourselves, and particularly those most vulnerable, safe in our buildings. But we will report back next week on that. And finally, I think there's one or two tickets left for the pantomime, if anybody wants to go along to that. That's not this week, it's the following week, so it's rather close, and I hope it will be as enjoyable as those in previous years. That, I hope, is all the notices, unless I missed something, in which case we will stand there and sing our final hymn, hymn number 742. promises and obey his will. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.